Fuck.
And Kyle, what's wrong?
Man, nothing, man. These fucking robots trying to fuck my day up.
I mean, look at this, man. We got guns.
You're right.
We got swords.
You're right.
Look at life. We could save the world, bro.
Man, you know what? You're right.
Let's do it.
Man, thanks, Rob.
Oh, you got it, Kyle.
I got two laser guns, and I know how to fucking use them.
200 points.
Man, nigga, oh my God.
I got hit.
Is anybody documenting this greatness? Oh, it's getting dark.
Hey, you see those big elephants?
What the fuck?
I feel like my whole life just changed.
That was crazy, yo.
I think of all my favorite rappers when I was growing up, and I've said this before, as superheroes, right? I always liked to learn how Peter Parker got bit by the spider, how Captain America got frozen and injected with the serum. I wanted to figure out how Super Duper Kyle, I know it's just Kyle now, but how Super Duper Kyle became Super Duper. So you have kind of the video games, and this spurs your imagination, and music is the other kind of big part of your superpowers and what makes you who you are. Your grandparents played a lot of music in the house. Not necessarily hip hop or rap music, but they played the Rat Pack, right?
Yeah, they were definitely not playing rap songs. They played Dean Martin, they played Frankie Lane. So like I would go over to my grandparents' house and they'd just slap them Frankie Lane. And I'd just come in there and try to do the whole thing, like, hey.
You moved around a little bit. Ventura, California is one of the spots that really kind of made you who you are. But there just wasn't much hip hop at all, right? Your mom was playing like rock music and pop.
All I listened to was K-Rock. When I was in the car, I got to listen to K-Rock. And when I got home, because we lived with my grandparents, I got to listen to Dean Martin. That was it.
Everybody loves somebody sometimes.
And then it was like the moment Ja Rule was on the TV or something, my grandma was like, oh, it changes it. So it was like, there was no way for me to get to it.
So then about 10 years old, you're driving around in the car with your dad.
Yeah, I'm riding around with my dad because I didn't really get to kick it with my dad that much. I'm riding around with my dad and all of a sudden, Old Dirty Bastard comes on. That just comes on and I'm like, oh my God. Now imagine the story I'm telling you about only K-Rock, Dean Martin, and then that. It sounds weird to say that I had a culture shock to hip hop. But I for real did. Just subconsciously hearing that first made me just not give a fuck. I was just wilding after that.
And your father was heavy into hip hop though. He used to rap, he used to take you to the studio, right?
Yeah, my dad was a rapper, break dancer. I think car salesman at some point. He did a lot of stuff. The thing is, I was always writing poetry and shit. You know, I'm like, man. Yeah, I mean, we'd be doing shit like that.
I'm like, I relate.
Yeah, I mean, going to the back of the class and just writing poems and shit. So, you know what I mean? I just didn't rap, but I had already written songs and shit. I was already musical, you know? The next day, I called my dad and I was like, Dad, you know how did you play? Yeah, I think I just did one too. Yeah, it's like to the Scarface thing, but watch. It kind of became our thing. And then he would like take me to studios. So I was like going to these studios and shit, going up in there. I'm like, hey, what's up, y'all? I'm like, yeah, I rap. Oh my God, we got to record this little kid. And then my dad would be like, what, you trying to record my son? Oh, what, you don't think, what? You don't fuck with him because he's short, huh? He was definitely the master splinter to my rap life.
What does he think about your raps now?
He still tells me, you need to get your balls up. I started telling him, hey, Dad, take that up with management. I gotta call you back.
You know, you talked about this before. Another song, an artist came along that kind of helped shape you was Big Sean dropped the freestyle over.
Yeah, over Lemonade.
Yep. And I'm unusual as shit. I'm super bad.
I grew up in the era of hip hop being stupid hard, like, you know what I'm saying?
DMX,
like,
Rough
DMX,
Riders.
I was all backpack, you know what I'm saying? And then when I heard Big Sean, Super Duper Lemonade, something about the energy of it was hella fun. It was like, I didn't feel like I had to be hella hard. That's why I covered Lemonade, was because of Big Sean. That's actually the reason I called myself like Super Duper Kyle, and the reason I called myself like KID was because in the beginning it goes, it's B-I-G. And I did the same thing. And I was like, oh, that's tight. All my homies used to just make fun of me and be like, bro, you talk white as hell. You sound like a white soccer mom. What's up with you, bro?
How does it feel now? Because I definitely seen the term dude rap.
Dude rap?
Thrown around. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? We're talking about Valley rap.
Yeah, Valley rap. You know what I'm saying? Definitely. Yo, Valley rap is for sure a genre.
It was always kind of this outsider thing, and it was just you being you. And now you're at a point where they love you for being you. A lot of times I think people used to use that as a negative, and it's like, no, yeah. That's why we love Kyle, because he's...
Yeah. The way I always think about it is like regardless if you like me or not, let's say I'm not even a nice guy. Let's say I'm a complete asshole. I'm just this terrible thing, right?
Only when you're playing video games.
Only when I'm playing video games. I am kind of an asshole when I play video games. I'm not gonna lie. And so it's like, regardless if somebody liked it or not, it's like, I can't, what do you want me to do? You want me to change? I can't change.
I mean, so you're out here making tapes, KID, and trying to find yourself, and you're in high school, right, doing the KID tapes. I want to get over to Beautiful Loser. Because Beautiful Loser 2, just the title, is not anything connected to rap.
Yeah.
It's connected to, what's that a reference to?
My Aunt Betsy played me this Bob Seger song called Beautiful Loser, which is amazing.
Beautiful loser.
And it's just a story of this person that kind of doesn't need to change, you know what I mean? Definitely in high school and just kind of in life in general, like, I had, like, cut the football team because I thought all of them were whack. I cut, you know what I'm saying, the track team. They were cool, but just, like, I entered high school popular as hell, right? Because I was like one of the only black kids, so they just assumed I was good at sports.
Yeah, they just put you...
Oh, they put me on everything, bro. And I was like, no, I'm trash at all this. You don't understand. You're making a mistake. The coach was like, get in there. So I guess I was just kicking it with like all the wrong people at first. Egotistical, kind of shallow, like not too nurturing people. And then when I found the drama club and I started kicking it with all these people who were hella funny, hella accepting, hella nice, like all these beautiful things, right? But they were the losers. And it just never added up to me.
It's funny when you describe the drama kids and how you came from the sports world, kind of hanging out with the jocks, and then looking up to you and telling them how cool they are. It kind of reminds me of like how you activate your fan base. Like that might have been like your first case test for Kyle's fans. You know what I'm saying? Like because you really through your music instilling your fans to be themselves and to be happy with themselves and be cool and not worry about what the rest of the world thinks.
It was kind of like a defense mechanism for myself and like my own sanity. My grandpa had like passed away during then, like when I was like end of like my 10th grade year. After that, bro, I was just so depressed, you feel me? He wasn't just my like male figure, he was everybody in my household's male figure. So we were all hella sad. So there was nowhere to pull, you know what I'm saying, some like positive shit from. So I had to just make it up myself. And it gave me like a new purpose.
Let's talk about the role that DJ Carnage played in your career. DJ Carnage comes around, big things start to happen.
Bobby Gordon though. Carnage, he found my shit and was like, let's fuck with him. A long time ago, 2011, 2012. I spent the night at his house one night, went to the studio and made Keep It Real the next day. He was just like, yeah, this is gonna be your biggest record.
Biggity bang, yep, bang, nigga. Kyle doing my thing.
You know, you get painted as kind of this happy guy and this happy-go-lucky, but like you said, there's definitely sad moments. There's definitely emotion.
Yeah,
the range of emotion, I think Remember Me shows that emotion. Yeah.
Hey, look, the happy rapper's not so happy now. I remember when I used to laugh a lot. Nowadays, I only LOL. Through text.
Man, I love Don't Wanna Fall in Love, man. The James Child sample, the video. Video is fun. The boxing ring when you guys have to dance off at the end.
Served, yo. She was really punching the shit out of me too. They'd be like, all right, now I hit him. I'd be like, okay, we're just gonna fuck around. She was just, wham. And I was just like, fam.
Last year you just dropped songs, right? You're in between Smile Is Out Already. You just give us like Doubt It. You give us Blame.
Yeah.
You give us iSpy. And it's not really a project. It just feels like singles and things that you're doing for your fan base.
Yeah.
Did you know that iSpy was gonna take off and be the one out of that pack?
When I say this too, I can't even like, I can't make it up. Like, I had zero idea.
I ain't been getting high.
I had no plan for it. iSpy was just like my kid that like, if he didn't go to college, it was cool. Like, I had no expectations for any of this. I was doing the whole project thing, you know, 2 years on a project, and I was just like, bro, let's just put out some songs and say, fuck it. Let's just drop a song every month. And then we did Doubt It. We're like, oh, this is kind of banging. And then we noticed, oh, we can do some shows again. Shit, oh, we're not completely falling off. Because we didn't know if we wanted to put iSpy out, bro. I didn't know if I wanted to drop it.
What's the hesitation? Why wouldn't you drop it?
Oh, my God. It really was a timing thing. We had nothing to drop. And we were like, all right, fuck it. Let's just drop iSpy.
Usually I would call you on your bullshit.
Yeah.
But I'm inclined to believe you, one, because you're a nice guy. You never lied to me as long as we've known each other. But there's a line in the song that says, this isn't the album. These are just the throwaways.
I meant it, bro.
This is not the album either. These are just the throwaways.
That's how much in that mode I was really like, had zero plans for anything.
Your mind has to be blown right now. Like, what is your dad saying now?
My dad is really just still calling me about bars and shit. Like, hey, I heard that shit. You know what I mean? He was saying on Hot 97, I'll flame you right now. Well, you, matter of fact, put a beat on. I know you got a phone. Play a beat. I got to get these bars off. I'll be like, dad, relax.
I just want to gauge if you are getting a feel for what's going on in this moment in hip hop, right? It's this new wave and this new thing happening and the new generation really taking over. And it's been fun to watch. And, you know, I put, you know, Chance the Rapper and all he's done in that category.
Yes, definitely.
You put Yachty in that category.
Yes, definitely.
I put Kehlani in that category.
Definitely.
I put Kyle in that category. And I mean, how do you feel you fit into this new generation of hip hop? Does it feel like a new energy? Are you part of the group that's going to take it to the next 10, 20 years?
There's definitely a brand new energy. The generation of hip hop that is like kind of free to do what we want because of the internet. You feel me? There's two things. I feel like the older generation of hip hop has to just like kind of allow us to do our thing. And then the younger generation of hip hop must pay respects to the older generation of hip hop.
I don't think there's any rule that says hip hop can't be fun. You know, there was Kid and Play. There was Criss Cross. Like, so hip hop has never been.
There was Fresh Prince and Jazzy Jeff.
There has never been just like 100% serious street.
Yeah.
East Coast, West Coast, or you're from the South at one time. There was always stuff sprinkled in.
We can do whatever we want to do, man.
You keep doing what you want to do, man. And you know, I look forward to more conversations like this after the album comes out. I look forward to more Big and his singles, man.
Thank you, bro.
Love you for sitting with us.
Man, I love you too, bro. Give me a hug, bro. Love the shit, man.
Oh, my God. I need a different type of ammo. This is booty.
Yo, you got a name on here?
Wow. One finger out of commission. Nah, and then you gotta have like the old, you know, I mean the British lady voice, like, finger badly damaged.